हेलो, हाय, गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन।
हाय।
श्योर दीपा, सो विल टेक द क्वेश्चन इन द लास्ट, सो आई विल टेक देम।
ओके okay।
Okay, so like you know, what we did was like yesterday we had started off with the R. I hope now installations and everything would be done with everyone, right? Like the R, R studios, all up and running.
Amit, can you please share the link again?
Download software.
Yeah, so first I have to download Seed RAN.
Crayon.rstudio, I'm just sharing the link.
Okay.
So this is where you will be landing up.
Okay.
Look, sorry, I'll share something else. So here is that link. So once you come on this link, you just have to click on, like, if you're using it on Windows or Mac, depending on that, you just have to go over here.
And once this is installed, then
R Studio.
When I'm clicking on this CRAN, it gives me R for Windows, base, contrib, old contrib, I don't know. Base, I have to install base, right?
Yeah. Obviously, if you come over here, this download R4 window, so install R for the first time. And this is the link where you will come up. And second is this, R Studio Desktop. So this is where you can do it.
All right, thank you.
Okay. In the meantime, we'll just start with some stuff over here. So in the meantime, you know, any questions from the yesterday session, right? Like vectors, and is it sorted to all of you? Like the vectors that we were talking yesterday, like what are vectors? So vectors are basically, you know, one dimensional way of storing your data, and all the data has to be of the same type, right? Like we created some vectors the yesterday, right? Like we were creating ages, right? We were storing all the data of same type only, right? Like colors, ages, and likewise. So it's the concept of indexing. So indexing in R starts from one, right? The first number, that first value that you store inside a vector, it will by default be having an index number as one over here. Okay. Then we get a couple of vectors. We were seeing how we can do the indexing on that. If you want to pick a particular value from there, how you can do it, how you can find the sum, minimum, max, and average, how we can do some sorting of the data. So for that, we had discussed on two methods. One was order and one was sort. Okay. So that was the part up till where, you know, we had done all the things. Similarly, if you want, if you talk about the vectors now. So just one or two more things I would like to show you. Suppose, you know, I have a vector with me. Suppose let's create a new vector. See, you see now everything is now deleted. Like, because I've opened this R again, fresh R. So there is no global environment or no variable that I see over here. So what we'll do is we will create let's create temperature. Let's create a variable temperature. And this, I would like to store the temperature of 5 days, 25, 27, 23, 28, 29, right? So this is what I'm storing as a vector now. So please create this vector. Okay, so I hope this the variable, right? So what I do want to do is, suppose I want to see the values. I say temperature more than 25, right? So if I put up this condition, so if you will see the output that I will get is, I get the output in the form of false, true, true, right? Basically, when you put something like this, when you are putting a comparison operator, right? So when you're saying that you want to see the values from that vector where the temperature was more than 25. So right away what happens is it gives me that for the first value, the condition is false. For the second value, the condition is true. For the third condition, it is false. And for the last two, it is again true over here. That is something that I can see in this, right? Temperature is more than 25. So now, basically, this is the output that you would have all would have not expected, right? You would have expected that the output should have come up as 27, 28, and 29. So why we are getting this output is because this is the same concept of sorting, right? The order function that we discussed yesterday. So when you use order function, it gives you the index number, right? Similarly, when you put some comparison operators in the vector, it by default gives you the output in the form of the true and false, where the condition is true and where the condition is false. So what we do is we actually write like this, right? Temp, and you will have to give the condition like this. You want to see those values where the temperature is more than 25. Because now what will happen is, it's like putting the indexing, right? So you are saying wherever the condition is true, only those numbers will come in the output. So you see now 27, 28, and 29. Now these are the numbers where the temperature is more than 25. Yes, Adhika, something similar to for the Python only. So you will find a lot of similarity between that, right? R and Python, you will find a lot of similarities in terms of the way we write the code and the terminologies, also quite a few terminologies that we will be using. They will be very much similar. Okay, so now the next thing that I show you over here is like, suppose if you want to find the value where the temperature is equals to 25, right? So you will say temp equals to 25. If you have to use equals to. So in that case, what we do is we use double equal to, because single equal to is a assignment operator, right? Single operator means you want to assign the values. So we use double equal to. So if I run this, so there is only one value, so you get 25 in the output.
Amit, can I use this operator? I mean, the temp greater than 25 as in a variable, and I can use that variable like I have pasted in chat. Will that work?
One second. This will work. This is the same thing.
Yeah, the temp of temp seems to be confusing to me. As a beginner, I want to learn like this, thought of confirming with you.
So it's the same. You have just saved it as a value. So you are giving, suppose, condition one, and you just give it like this. You save it, temp equals to 25. So you run this. You can check this out, CN1, what is that? So you get the same output over here. Right, so then you can just put this over here, temp and the CN1.
Okay, getting it. Thank you.
I think, you know, this would be more rather, you know, like as a beginner, I think this is more straightforward, right? You are just simply seeing what you are putting in this. We are going into multiple steps, right? You are assigning a variable, checking the variable, then again using that variable. So this is a more straightforward approach if you see over here from that, you know, the bigness, because variables are more something which, you know, when we get a little exposure, we start understanding them more and how this concept of variable is working. So it's more like, you know, I will say more like when we get a little exposure. So over there, I should be rather using this approach. Right now, I think this is very straightforward if you will try to see that what I'm trying to see right now.
Okay, if you follow, okay, in this approach, right, temp of, you are just checking the condition, whether the temperature vector is equal to 5, the vector item, or this is the condition.
Sorry, can you go again, please?
This particular condition, right, temp equal to 25.
Mm-hmm.
Again, you are giving temp of, so I'm just... kind of waving here and there. So I followed this approach. I couldn't get exactly what it is. Temp of. This I got. You are just checking the condition.
Okay. So now what we do is, the next thing that we start over here is, that would be matrices. So now see, what we have done over here is that we have learned about the vectors. So vectors are one-dimensional way of storing the data, right? Now, when we talk about matrices, right? So where have you all heard about matrix now, right? So matrix is something that we all have heard of, right? Mathematics. So in the matrix, what we used to do was... So we used to have a concept of rows and columns, right? Like this is what we used to have, the rows and columns. So like in this case, I have... four columns and I have 3, 4, 5, 6 rows. So this is something that is called as a matrix now, right? And we used to have a nomenclature for this, R cross C, that how many rows and how many columns. So I have 6 rows, 6 cross 4. So we call this as a 6 by 4 matrix, right? This is what we call this as 6x4 now. So this is a similar thing that we are going to do over here. So like in the metrics, in the mathematics, we used to store numbers, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, something like this. We used to store numbers over there. Similarly, in R, a matrix is a concept. It's a two-dimension structure of storing the data. The data must be of same type, right? This is what we do in this, right? The data must be of same type. Again, you cannot store multiple data types, right? The data can be only of one type over here. So let us try to create this. So first of all, just follow it up and just take a look at it. Then you all do it on your screen, right? So I create a first matrix over here. Let me call it as mat1. See, you know, when you declare the name of the variables, so just a couple of rules. Variable name cannot start with number or special character. Variable name cannot have space. Okay, so these are two things that you should take care of, right? So like mat1, if you want to give a space, you can use underscore, mat_1. So I am creating one variable mat1, and now I will use a function matrix, right? So now this matrix function is something that is going to give me a matrix in the output. So I am saying I want to create a matrix with numbers from 1 to 25. So I say 1 to 25. So this is simple stuff. This is what I'm doing now. I am saying I want to create a matrix with numbers from 1 to 25. So matrix is created. I can see a variable has been read over here, mat1. So let us check out the output now. If I say mat1, this is what I get in the output. I get 25 numbers. So this output is very different from what we saw in a vector, right? In a vector, we were getting in one single row all the 25 numbers. But because in a matrix, we have the concept of rows and columns, right? So first we write rows and then we write column, right? The same concept. So you over here see it is saying this is first row, second row, third row, fourth row. And this is written comma 1. That is, this is the first column, right? If I see at this value, this is 5, 1, right? 5, 1. This is the address of this value. Fifth row, first column. This is 8th row, first column. So right now what I've done is I have made a very basic by default matrix over here, correct? Just to make you show that how a matrix will look like when you create it in the R over here. The concept of rows and columns, right? Making sense to all of you? What we have created over here, this matrix. Right, so now again, all please try it at your end. Just try to make this matrix. Then we will be doing a lot of modifications on it.
Hey, Amit, I'm just trying to compare when we were doing this in Python also. There was something similar we were doing, right? Where we were just having random numbers created, table, and then to show the table, we were in the console, we were writing a different code. I'm forgetting that. What was it called there?
Sorry, like you're comparing matrix in Python?
Yeah, so when we were creating a similar table in random numbers, using random numbers, what was it called there? Do you remember? Something from D, I think.
Dictionary?
Yeah.
Dictionary. But dictionary over there, you know, still it can, so dictionary also is on a similar line. So we can just define the columns and everything.
And then when we were showing it in the console there as a table, that was also dictionary?
In the console?
Like when we were showing it as a table, like a proper...
No, that was a data frame.
Data frame, okay.
So we call that as a data frame over here also, in R also.
Okay.
Right after this matrix, we will be talking on data frames. See, are you all able to create this? R comma C. Suppose, you know, I have a vector with me. Suppose student dot ages. Okay, suppose this is a vector in which suppose I store the data of 5 ages. One is of 21, 26, 28, 29, 30. Let's create this vector. Now if I convert this also into matrix, right? MAC 2. I create a matrix over here. And I give the input as student.ages. Okay. So if I see over here now, this matrix student MAC 2 that I have created. So let's see the output. So you can give the variable as a vector also, right? So I've given that input as a vector. Now that vector will get converted into matrix. So 21, 26, 28, 29. So when we are creating matrix, so by default, what is happening is, by default, we are getting one column. Okay, this is what we are getting in the output. Now what we will do is, we will create a matrix. In this input that I am giving over here is, that is 25 numbers, 1 to 25. But now I will define that, you know, I want 5 rows, right? Number of rows equals to 5. So n row stands for number of rows. So I'm defining in the matrix that 25 numbers that I have given in the input, they should be bifurcated into, they should be inserted into 5 rows. Now, if I have 5 rows, so how many columns will I get by default? Like, because it's a matrix. So matrix is more like a rectangular distribution that we have, right? Rows and columns. So it will get, if I put that in 5 rows, we'll go into 5 columns now, right? So I will get 5 columns. So if you make this up, MAC 3. Okay, so you will now see the numbers have been divided into 5 rows and 5 columns.
Can you explain that again, please? Why, when we are writing n row, is giving us 5 columns?
Sorry?
Can you explain that, please, again?
So what I'm saying is, I have 25 numbers, which I want to put into a matrix. Correct? So now see, 20, the matrix that we have, it's a combination of rows and columns, right? Like, for example, if I have 6 rows and 4 columns, that means total number of, the total numbers that I can insert over here are, there are 6 into 4, that is 24, right? These, that would be the total number of numbers that I can insert in. That is what we mean by the term. That is what we understand by the term.
Right.
Matrix. So now I have 25 numbers with me. So I am saying, can I put 25 numbers in a matrix of 6 by 4? No, because numbers are 25. And 6 by 4 matrix is going to give me only 24 cells that I can use. So there will be one number that will be left off. Now I am saying, let's put the 25 numbers in a 5 cross 5 matrix. That is the only possibility that I can have, 5 cross 5 matrix.
Yes.
Right. So I have defined in that I want to have 5 rows. So I am saying I want to have 5 rows. So if I have 5 rows and data is 25, so by default it makes sense that, you know, automatically I will get the 5 columns only, correct? So that is what we have done. So I am saying that I want to put 25 numbers into 5 rows, number of rows as 5. So it creates 5 rows and 5 columns automatically.
Okay, but instead of n row equal to 5, can we directly give the column number of columns we want to create?
So you can give any of the one thing, man. Either you give number of rows or you give number of column. You can give any one of them.
Number of column will be n c o l.
That will be n c o l. So if you say n c o l equal to 5, that will be number of columns.
Okay. Okay.
Now, what is the difference actually, n row and n column? The output is same, right?
N row is number of rows.
Yeah, I got it. But logical wise, I'm asking, is there any difference or in the output format while displaying?
No, nothing will be different. We are just defining the number of rows and columns like
that. Okay.
So either you say I want 5 rows or you say 5 columns. If you have 30 data, 30 numbers with you, you say I want to have 3 columns. So by default, you will get 10 rows, right? Or you say I want 3 rows, you will get 10 columns, right? 3 into 10. So that is what we are defining to have that structure with us, that what matrix we want to create. So you can define n row or n column.
Okay.
So this is number of rows. This is number of columns. Okay. For example, now if I come over here, I create a mat 3, a mat 4 rather. And suppose now I'm creating a matrix in which I'm giving the input from suppose 51 to 100. Now I'm giving 50 numbers in this. Now what I can do is I can create a matrix. Suppose I say I want to create a matrix of 10 columns. So I will say n col equals to 10. So if I say 10 columns over here, right? So you see I get 10 columns and 5 rows, right? 5 into 10, that gives me 50 numbers. So you have to be a little careful with this, right? Because suppose now if suppose you give the number of column as, let me create this matrix again, and suppose you give the number of columns as 12, right? Now you're giving the number of columns as 12 over here. Now is there a way I can create a matrix in which I can say that I want to insert 50 numbers and I want 12 columns?
No, because that will create a decimal number 4.16.
So you get something like, so like if you do that now, right? So you get, see, matrix is still created, but you get a warning message. See, a matrix has been created with a warning message. So let us see what is actually created. If you will see right now over here, it has not given the numbers up till 50. I mean, it has, if you will see, it has taken the numbers up till 100. And then after that 10th column, it has inserted that same values again in order to give you a square matrix. Because technically the input that you gave was incorrect, but still what it did was it gave you a warning that you have not given a correct multiple of a row and column. So now because you have said that you wanted to have 12 columns now, right? And the values are only 50. So it has created 12 columns and 5 rows. So that way you will get 60 values. So that 10 values, it has just included extra. You see these 10 values that are coming? These are the same values from the starting which have been repeated over here. Because the matrix couldn't be created with that. So it didn't give you any error. It has still created it with the repetitive data now. Getting it? Okay. So what I'll do now is, let us create mat 5. Again, a matrix. Now I'm going to add the numbers, simple numbers, right? 1 to 25 only. And I'm going to say number of rows that I want are 5. So I get a mat 5. So in this matrix, you will notice that the numbers are being inserted column wise, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Suppose I want the numbers to be inserted in this way. right? Like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I want the numbers to be inserted in this direction. So how can I do that? So for that, we have to use another component, that is by row equals to true. By row means that you want to insert the data row wise. So by default, it is false. So over here, I am turning it on that I want to insert the data by row. So if you see now, if I'll show you the mat file, the numbers are now inserted row wise. First, all the data in the first row, then in the second row, then in the third row. So you can see, you can change the entry of the data as well, that how the data is inserted. Okay, are you all with me on this, what we have done up till now? Okay, see now what we do over here is, this metric that we have created, we can give some proper row names, right? If you see right now, this is, these names are not coming properly. So what I can do is, if you define, if you want to give row names, and column names. So we have the functions for that. Like if you say row names of mat 5, you want to give some row names. Suppose the row name is, you want to give the row names as row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4, row 5, you can give some row names to them, right? So you see now, if I'll show you the mat 5, so you will see the row names are defined. Like we are defined in the case, like we had defined the names in the matrix. So over here also we can define the names, but now since in a matrix, we have rows and columns, so you can define row names and call names. So you can define the column names as well, right? So mat 5, I want to define the column names as CL1, CL2, CL3, CL4, and CL5. So this is how I can give the names. What if there are thousands of rows? Yeah, so see, if you have thousands of rows, so if you want to give some the names over there, so we can use the concept of loop. So we can write a loop as well. So you need to have those thousand values or thousand names that you want to give. You need to have them defined somewhere, right? Like you will have them, okay, or you will be creating like this only row one, row two, row three, if you will be following the same pattern. So you can write a loop for that, right? Like for I equals to 1 to that, if you have 10,000 rows, 1 to 10,000, and you will say row names of mat 5, each row you will define with the help of a loop. So you can use loops over there.
I didn't understand, Amit.
Hello?
Yeah, sorry, I did not understand what you said.
You're asking all these 1,000 rows, na?
Yeah.
So see, there is a concept of loops. So looping is a concept in which what we do is, if you have to do the same thing, right? If there is something, suppose something, there is a task that you have to do 1,000 times. So instead of writing the code 1,000 times, what we do is we write it inside a loop. So we will say that this thing should repeat 1,000 times now. So with the help of loops, we can name 1,000. If you have suppose 1,000 rows. Now let me ask you a question over here. Okay. Suppose you have 1,000 rows of data with you, right? Like suppose this is the Excel, okay, and over here you have some data with you. So there are 1,000 rows. Now, what are the 1,000 row names that you want to give? What name do you want to assign to them?
So in the same pattern, like R1 to R1000, I mean, the same
R1
way.
R1 to R1000, yeah. Right? So what you are doing over here is basically, if you see the row names are changing R, and if the row number is 1, it is R1, but R remains the same, right? The next thing, the row number is 2, it becomes R2. So if I concatenate it, it will become R1 and R2, correct?
Yeah.
So every time what you see is the same thing is happening. We are picking the R and we are picking the row number. R and the row number. R and the row number. So this something I can put it inside a loop. So we have the concept of loops in the coding, which we will be doing in the R also. I will say for X equal to 1 to 1000. We have 1000 rows. I will simply say that the names that I want to define, the row names of that mat, right? So they will go like R into X. So this is the piece of code that I will have to write and next. So what will now happen is this loop will run 1000 times. The first time the loop will run, the value of X will be 1. So it will become R1. Next time the loop will be run, X will be 2. So it will become R2, R3, R4. It will keep on running for 1000 times. Mm-hmm. So you will be able to achieve that.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Amit, can we give the row names and column names while creating the matrix?
By clicking the?
While creating it itself, like when we said mat 5 is mat matrix 1 is to 25, n row equal to 5 by row equal to t. Over there, can we give the row names and column names?
Over there also, we can give that. So we use dim name as a function over there. So we can do that at that point.
What will be the function there? The same? Row names mat 5 or?
No, so there is dim name that we use.
Dim names, okay.
Dim names, yeah. Dimension names. So now if you take the matrix now, let's take a look at the matrix mat 5 that we have written now. So you can see that row names and column names have been defined. Okay. So now what we do over here is the same thing, slicing and indexing, something that we learned on the vectors, the same thing can be done and will be applied over here also. Right now, because over here we have a 2x2 matrix, the things will be a little different. Suppose I want to, from this matrix, I want to pick this value. Okay, I want to pick this value number 50. So how will I pull this out? What will be the indexing? See, indexing follows the same. 1 to 5 and 1 to 5, right? Indexing always starts from 1. So if I say from the mat 5, I want to pick the value which is at row number 3 and column number 5. So first you give the row number, then you give the column number, correct? So it will give you that value. At the intersection of that row and column, it will give you that value. That is 50. Yeshweta. So basically, row names are it's a predefined function. Okay. So can you all write a code? I would like to extract this value now. Comma 4, right? So that will be mat 5, 2. So row number is 2, column number is 4. So I get 9 in the output. Perfect. Okay. Now, what I would like to do is I would like to extract the complete row, right? This complete row is something that I want to extract. So what we do is over here, I will say mat 5. Okay. So I want to extract the complete row, right? So when I'm talking about this, so what is the row number? Suppose I want to extract this row. So this is row number 5 or row number 2, comma. Now I will leave the columns as blank, right? Blank means I want all the columns now. So if I run this now, so you will get that 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Mat 5, 2, comma, and you leave it blank. Okay. If I say I want to pick the column number 4, I want to see the data of fourth column. So that will become mat 5. All the rows, column number 4. Now, if I come back to this mat 5, okay. Now, what I would like to do is I want to see this data in the output. Right? 4, 5, 9, 10. This is what I want to see in the output now. So, how we will fetch this? Now there are two things. Please watch mat 5. So what are the row numbers? Row numbers are 1 and 2. So because whenever you have to give more than one value, it will come always inside a vector. So I will say C 1 comma 2. These are the row numbers, comma C 4 comma 5. These are the column numbers. So you see 4, 5, 9, 10.
We can also do it with a semicolon instead of C.
That can also be used. So semicolon is also like a vector only. So you can see either C, you can use C, or you can say 1 to 2 and 4 to 5.
Amit, but what if we want to pick different numbers which are not placed together? So
then you have to use this technique only.
Yeah, then this one is better.
I hope everyone is clear. Anyone, any questions or any doubts up till here? Now, you know, if you come on this matrix, suppose you want to find the sum of this, you can simply say sum of mat 5. So when you say sum of mat 5, it is going to give you the overall sum. It is going to add up all the numbers. If you say mean of mat 5, it is going to give you the average. Then there are two functions which we call it as row sums, and we have the row call sums. Row sums and call sums. Okay. So like if you use this now, if I say row sums of mat 5, it will add up the data row wise. It is going to add the data row by row, right? Like first row, then the second row, then the third row. This is adding the data row wise over here.
What was the shortcut of making a text as comment? Keyboard shortcut?
Control Shift C.
Okay. So if you will use call sums, it is going to give you the sum column wise. So can you all now create a matrix, something like this? Suppose these are the temperatures. On day one, the temperature in India was this, day two, day three, day four, day five. And in US, this was the temperature. Can you all create this matrix now? You have to create a matrix in the R, which should look like this. You have the names, you have the column names. So this is what you have to do now. So let's try to create it. So I just give you 2 minutes, 2 to 3 minutes. Let's try to make this up. I'll just get back in a minute. So many times to create it.
Okay, so I see many of you have done it. So there we go. Right, so first you just get a vector and then you have to put it into a matrix. So that is how it is going to work, right? So what we do is, I come over here, first of all, I will have to create a vector itself, right? Suppose I get a vector by the temperature. So in that, what I will have to do is, I will be putting all these values. That these are my values. Okay, so then what we do is we get a matrix. Let me call it as country underscore temp. And in this, I'm going to say matrix. My input is temp. Number of rows, I want 2. And by row equals to true. So if you can see this, this is how this matrix looks like 12, 13, 15, 16, 17. Now what I need to do is I need to define the row names. Row names of country temp. Right? So we define the row names as the India and the US, right? And then you define the column names. So column names of country underscore temp, they are day 1, day 2, day 3, day 4, day 5. So we will see the matrix now. So this is how it looks like.
But can you please show by using dim names?
Sorry?
Can you please use dim names and show? I was trying it, but the code is not right.
Sure, I'll just do that.
Amit, can we use two vectors in the matrix? Like we can we create India temperature in one vector and US temperature in one vector? Can we use two vectors in matrix?
No. So if you want to do them, you have to give them together. So basically what you do is, like, for example, if you create, let me show you. So these are the first five values, right? So you are saying that you have created this India, right? So this is the first vector that you have created. So in this, okay, and you create a US, and in this, what you do is you give the another five values. So when you combine the two vectors, you can do that, right? Like you will say US, India, comma, US. This way you can write. So this is how you will combine it. So you see now the bold values are combined together. Okay?
Okay.
So like for this, like Radhika, you're asking. So suppose you create a matrix now. you say give the numbers from 1 to 25 and you are saying you want to have number of rows equals to 5, right? So what you do is you have this dim names, right? So you say dim names equal to, right? You will have to give this like this, right? List. So first you give the row numbers, row names, and then the column names. Suppose you want to give the row names as R1, R2, R3, R4,
okay,
and R5. So you have to define both of them together. So these are the row names. And then you don't want to give the column name. Suppose you define that as null. Okay. So this is how you're going to do it. So you get R1, R2, R3, R4, R5.
Hmm.
And this I have not defined. That I've given as null. But if you want to give that, you can do that also.
So just write C and then bracket and then the column names.
Column names.
Yeah. I was doing this, but I was doing all of this except that I was not putting it in a list.
Okay, you're not using list.
Yeah.
Okay. So now you know what you can do is this matrix that we have created, right? This country matrix that we created. It can come up that you might want to add some new rows and column to this matrix, right? If you want to add a new row and column, we have the functions called as cbind and rbind, right? Cbind is a function we use to add a row and, sorry, to add a column. And rbind is something that we use to add a row. Okay, this is where we use all these two functions over here, right? Cbind and rbind. So now suppose, you know, I want to add a new row as well, right? Suppose I want to add the data of UK as well. So I get the temperature of UK. So I have a vector with me. Suppose UK, the temperature was 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. These were the temperature on 5 days. So I will say that I want to update my country temperature matrix where I would like to add a row, rbind. What do I want to rbind? I want to rbind the data that I already have, comma, UK. So these two temperatures, these two data should be now combined together. So if you will see now, country temp, you see we have India, US, and UK. getting it? So what we have done is we have updated our country temperature, where we are saying R bind country temp variable comma the data that I have created.
I'm getting an error when I'm using dim name. Can I share my screen?
Yeah, sure.
So over here, I'm using dim names to create this matrix, and I've given the numbers which were there, and then I've specified number of rows, and then in dim names I did list column names, row names, and then I did null for column names.
Okay. The brackets, are they closed properly? So your bracket is not closed in the last, now. Just close it.
Closing the matrix bracket. Okay.
Now run it. And null will come in the caps. The null that you have written, that will all be in the caps. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Now the next thing that we do over here is, how can I add a column? Suppose I have the data of day six also, right? All the six countries, all the three countries, they have given me the data of the day six also. So what I do in this case is, suppose, or rather, you know what we can do, let's try to add an average. Suppose I want to add a new column where I want to show what was the average temperature. Any idea how can I do that? Right, so what I will do is I will get average. See, there is a function called as row means. I have to find the average of row. So there's a function of row means. Row means means when you want to find the average row wise. So if I say row means of country temp, it gives me that it will give me the average temperatures, right? 14.6, 25, 23. This was the average temperature for the three countries. So what I will do is, I will simply say that country temp that I have, I would like to update it. Okay, I would like to update it, where I will say that the data should be C bind. We are adding a column in this, C bind, and the data is country temp. Comma AVG. So I'm just adding a column to it. And if you will now see this, we get average. Okay, so this is how you can add a row and a column. So this is where, you know, I think we'll stop for the day today. Okay. So tomorrow we will be starting off with the next topic, that will be data frames, right? So request you all, right? So just go through the session of today. There are a lot of stuff that we have done. So matrices, and just give me a moment. So I'm sharing an assignment also over here, right? And the working file. Okay, yeah. So assignment for metrics and the codes that you are reading today. So I just shared both the things.
Amit, if you're done for the day, can I ask some questions?
Yes, please.
I'll share my screen, okay? I just surfed in net and I got this sample program, and this one I was trying by myself, this calculator program. And using this, I can able to get the input from the user, but after running this line, right, I want the system to prompt automatically for the second input. It is not doing that. If I run this line again only, I'm getting enter the option.
So because that happens in the batch processing, right? This is overhead, it's not a batch that we are running. So it is like a line by line code that happens. So it is going to take it one by one only. So you won't be able to run it in one go. So if you run it, so because when you run the first line, it takes the input and it stops. Then you have to run the second line again.
Okay, fine. If I want to, it won't be possible in R, like Python? Okay, fine. And one more thing, see, I'm getting all the outputs for this addition. Is my code wrong here for the mean?
So you can't give two variable input.
Okay.
I mean, so mean will be, so you are giving two different this over here, right? IP1 and IP2, have you created two different vectors?
No, I'm just getting the input from the user.
No, what is IP1? So basically IP1, that the input
integer, it's not a vector. No, it's not a vector actually. I'm getting the integer input from the user.
Can you run this mean value? Can you just run it once? I just want to see what do you have. So just run IP1 and IP2 separately.
Should I give you control?
Right now, IP1 is not created. So I have to first take that input.
Maybe you need to run where they've selected IP1 as the input one. Oh.
No, I have converted. Yeah, the input as
an IP. Yeah, convert character into integer.
because while running by myself, I got the output, but that is not correct for the mean.
So we're getting this. So what were the numbers? We gave 5 and 10.
Now it's correct.
Yeah. What you did, you added a parenthesis? No, you converted that. Okay.
Hello?
Vector. Okay.
Just a vector, yeah. Just
okay. Okay. And one more thing. Can you please scroll down? Yeah, here I have got, instead of getting the user from the output, from the sequential numbers, right, 25 to 29, I converted this particular thing as a vector. Is there any option for random numbers here in R?
And you want to generate random numbers?
Yeah.
Also, you have a couple of functions. One is right, runif. So if you use runif function, so this gives you random uniform numbers. Suppose you want 10 numbers between 20 to 50.
Okay.
It gives you that.
Okay.
Does it consider 50 also?
Sorry?
Does it consider 20 and 50 inclusive of those?
Inclusive.
And this new line character, right? It is not working for me. I tried with the slash and it is not working. Because, yeah, if you just scroll down. Yeah, here if I run this, my vector items are. So the range I'm giving 1 to till the length of that vector. I want this my vector as only once. And I want the new line character to be added, and I want to display only my vector items. Is it possible?
No. So it will come in the one line because it's a paste function, the concatenation of the data.
Okay. Okay. And this slash in, is it correct for this new line function in R, or it differs?
This slash n, I think it doesn't work. I will check that thing because I never used such that scenario.
Okay.
Slash n, I will have to check.
Okay. Yeah, this is all I have, Amit. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, guys.